I actually enjoy the countryside. I enjoy being outside. I like the fresh air. So the bike's quite good in that it gets you fit, gets you out there in the fresh air.
It's always nice to cycle, I think, in a new part of the world, somewhere I haven't been, that doing on your own would be really hard. But for me, I really like having a big trip to train for, to give you a reason to push yourself.
Really wanted to kind of push myself and just see if I could achieve and do 47,000 feet in 4 days.
I guess just recently, last 5 or 6 years, it's all about a bit about the friendships.
I found riding the Dolomites prettiest mountain range I've ridden in.
The rockiness of the mountains, really picturesque views every time you turn. It's just stunning.
The light reflecting off the glaciers at the top of the mountains, you really do see some spectacular sights, that's for sure.
When I put my lycra on and mount on my bike, all is well with the world. Any problems, any stress from work, it's out of the window. You're just thinking about the road and the people you're with.
As years have gone on, it's more the fact I enjoy riding with a group of people rather than riding on my own, because I enjoy the group of people I ride with more than the riding the bike, really, more than anything.
You know, cycling with people you know, cycling with people you like, it's just great fun. I wouldn't give it up for anything.
Riding long days, 460k, 12,000 metres of climbing, you've got to physically prepare, you've got to mentally be as good as you can be, and, you know, do the best you can to get through it. Not just to get through it, but, you know, enjoy and endure, really. That's the bottom line. I think when you look at it on paper, you realise, you know, this is going to be an effort.
Preparation was probably completely opposite to what I should have been doing. At the time, I was doing a bit of cyclocross, so training was really less than an hour, which, considering I was in the saddle for best part of 8 to 10 hours, proved probably not the right training strategy. So
we talked about it for months. People knew what to expect within reason, so if you don't do the training, it's going to hurt.
I did a huge amount of work in the early part of the year, cycling, swimming and running. Did a couple of 100-mile cycles. I didn't do any precise prep for the mountains.
I prepared in March by falling off my bike and potentially fracturing my pelvis. So that put my training back a little bit. But by July, I did a ride across the Pyrenees, the Raid Pyrenees. So that was really my base training for getting this done.
The unknown, really, pushing myself as far as I could go. I'm not sure whether I'd do it. That was probably the biggest thing, really, facing the biggest challenge I've ever done.
You sort of knew it was going to be really hard, but you don't quite realise how hard it is till you get there, and then it's too late to get a flight back to Birmingham.
I think it's all in the mind. I'm not quite sure you need to be that fit, you just need to be quite determined.
If you're not mentally ready for it, you can be defeated before you even start the trip.
It's a great challenge to finish it, but we won't go there. The key thing is with trips like that is if you don't prepare, you probably don't enjoy them as much as other people.
I knew it was going to be the longest day or the most climbing I've ever done in a day, so the speed of the group was of a bit of a concern.
There was a lot of talk before the trip about how difficult it was, and when you compare mileages and elevation gain, that was large. It was going to be the biggest day for most people have ever done on a bike, and that was only day one, so that was playing a lot of people's minds.
I had a lack of confidence, I have to confess, when I went into this whole trip. I'd almost talked myself into the fact that it was just too challenging.
I was excited about the route, however, I was also sort of concerned that I was going to sort of might have been the weakest link within the group.
Day one was very exciting.
The adrenaline was going, everyone was up early, still dark, which was a bit of a shock, really. So going through the town, pretty dark, and really didn't know what to expect, but It was all, for me personally, it's just about, I just wanted to make sure I could get it done.
No excuses, I know where all the pains come in. So I've got it all recorded. I'll probably be out of sync because I'll probably be about 2 minutes behind, so yeah, I'll be fine.
Phil is permanently full of shit because that's because he's just a machine, he's an Iron Man machine. But he's such a pussy, he hasn't got the tattoo yet. Need to get ready. On my wife's birthday. To go for a stupid fucking bike ride that this lot put together.
You waiting for me, boys?
Yeah. Thanks for turning up on the time.
Well, there's a certain magic about day one. It doesn't matter what tour you do, there's always a certain magic because everyone's looked forward to it. They've had their bike service. People have bought, I don't know, new shoes, new socks, new helmets, new sunglasses. People are genuinely excited about being on their bikes, more so than probably any other ride of the year. Ready for it, up for it. Probably a bit too old to be doing stuff like this. Probably drank a little bit too much last night to be doing stuff like this. But here we are, we're in the mountains and we're ready to give it some large.
2 minute warning, boys.
Darryl over analysing the situation. Right, let's go.
Yeah, looking forward to it. 5K in and that's when we put the hammer down. First climb, that's when we lose, hopefully wheels will be gone by that point, break him in the first 5k, and we'll pick him up again at lunchtime, broken.
And you roll out and people are a little bit nervous and, you know, you're trying to gauge other people's fitness. The scenery going around Lake Garda was stunning, and then we were soon onto our first climb, which had a series of switchbacks. Really exciting, beautiful grand depart, if you like, going around the lake. And just the air of anticipation of what lies ahead of you. By the time you've got up the Gavia eight hours later, I mean, that's faded quite a lot, but you know, setting off is super exciting.
After the first climb, I knew we weren't trying to rip each other's legs off, and I thought, actually, we're going to do this. I'm going to get through the day. So I felt quite good.
I'd chosen a great group of guys to ride with because we just kept ourselves motivated and giggling, even when there were the tough bits. It just made it a great day.
We're about one third done. One third done, the two hardest climbs to go.
And are you feeling confident?
Feeling fine. It's just a ride.
Bit left in there, you were there.
We're going in here. How was that then this morning?
Yeah, very good. Still a bit of a play there at the end.
Are any of those
Gazmus jumped on? I cheated Daz, so apologies Daz. That was your climb there, pal.
Were any of those
body was nowhere
climbs?
Near. Nowhere near. Sorry about that.
First climb was nice, we all kept together. Some of the light guys thought that they could whiz up that last one, but of course they haven't got the stamina nor the lungs to kind of keep it going. Another couple of kilometres and they'd have been out the back. You know, it wasn't a pretty sight watching them on the road this afternoon. I think they're going to be regretting that effort.
When you're down, you need people to drag you up. When you're, you know, on the rafters. You've got to be tucking in with your group, and we helped each other out. I mean, you know, the day one offset was fantastic. We said we wouldn't smash each other, and we didn't. You know, we rode hard, but yeah, you need that group set, that mentality, and everybody, you know, every day one, everybody was up for it, was thriving.
But I think the extremes of the climbs and the valleys, and you know, the sort of the range of temperatures you go through, the altitude, it creates a completely different climate.
Gary Price has got a lot to answer to, believe me.
And then when you look over your shoulder and you realise what you've just worked your way up, and you see the views, they're to die for, and they are picturesque, and you can see why, like the Stelvio Pass, you can see why that's such an iconic mountain.
Can't be far, is it? Oh, my legs. Cramping.
Hi.
You alright?
Yeah, I'm okay.
You alright?
I'm tired.
I know. Everyone's had a bit of a pit stop here.
Have they?
Yeah.
Good stuff. Oh. Remind me to give Gary a good slap tonight. Huh? And in particular, to give the, what's his name, Phil one.
Phil Boyd.
Phil Boyd says, no problem, Bob. It's all downhill from lunch.
Yeah, we've got to go up from lunch. We've got about 4K, I think.
Oh, sorry, is that on film? Hope not.
We can edit that bit.
There we are, picked that wind up down there, brought it all the way up here on my own. Yeah. Legs are gone.
Yeah.
Head's gone.
Everyone's had a bit of meltdown here. You're not the alone. Beds is fucked. Paul Wheeler.
What?
Whose fucking idea was this?
How far is it now?
About 4K, Joe, to the top, I think.
4K?
I think so. Have a look on that sign when you go past.
Yeah, it was a lovely day. Up until we started the Gavia. I think it's the hardest climb most people have ever done, for several reasons.
After being quite sick at the bottom and only really eating a packet of bacon fries before trying to do the ascent, which was the worst ascent I've ever done, really was not great, and that proved to be quite a difficult climb. Made a lot worse, really, the fact that I had to ride half of it with Paul Wheeler, which wasn't great either.
Torture, pure torture. You know, the road surface wasn't brilliant. You know, there were probably multiple areas where it was 16% plus. And then it's just starting to get pretty cold once you'd come out of that tunnel.
I was kind of lucky, I think, in that I hadn't pushed too hard earlier on in the day, so I still had energy left in the tank. And I was riding with Frank, so kind of well-paced up the hill, up the climb.
You kind of end up having a bit of an out-of-body experience. So you just have to disconnect your mind from your legs and think about something else.
The wind hits you sideways, you're hypothermic, it's -2 or -3, you know, you zip it up and you crack on, or you give up, and you can't give up on the climb to the Gavia, so you've got to suck it up.
Nearly there, boys, nearly there.
That was the only thing for me that made it a very tough day.
Pay you to take this bike off me.
This is fucking torture.
But at the same time, you couldn't see, it took away a sense, so you couldn't feel the pain in your legs anymore because you were concentrating on something else.
When the cold set in, towards the top of it, when the sun just started to drop.
Cold. Needles arm warmers out.
And the temperature really dropped and the winds picked up. And morale really dropped then, kind of. I just wanted to get over that and get to Bormio.
A little bit disorientated, and I was turning the pedals, and I actually thought I wasn't moving. However, as they say, there's always a light at the end of the tunnel. It took a long time to come to fruition, but the light did eventually come.
It was a good idea about 10K ago.
It's brutal parts.
Yeah, it's...
Yeah, that's brutally packed. Tunnel coming, it's just delirious, aren't it? You can't see shit.
And that descent, that was cruel, and I don't think I was alone in saying it was probably one of the toughest days on a bike I've ever had. And it was all about the last hour. the stuff before was that suffering that you used to. It was that tap it out. It was your mates are there doing it, so you're going to do it with them.
It was absolutely horrible. It just went on and on. And in the tunnel, if you weren't for the van, I don't think I couldn't see shit.
The whole time going up there, I just thought, how can anyone ever race a bike coming up here? I was surviving, and I don't often survive. You know, I found it incredibly difficult.
Any moments when you didn't think you'd get to the top?
About 2 hours of moments.
Yeah.
The van was there, all the kit was there, and I didn't actually kind of put the right clothes on for the descent, and within 5 minutes of descending I realised I was really in trouble. It was so cold, to a point that I was looking, when we got to the ski resort, I was looking for anything to be open because I would have stopped at that point. I mean, my only saving grace was I'd done that climb and I knew how long it would take to get to the bomb, but it was absolutely brutal, that last bit.
Halfway down the descent, I didn't feel right, so I pulled over for a moment. I hadn't got the right gear on, and I think that was another lesson. I rushed over the top with what I thought would be appropriate, and it wasn't, and very quickly felt the chill.
I mean, it was so cold, he couldn't stop shivering.
And then when my grip started to get affected, that was bad.
We couldn't literally pull the brake levers, we had to stop, and I had to warm my hands up just so I could feel them again to use the brakes on the descent on that, basically.
And I pulled over just to make sure I felt right. I was a bit lightheaded. And when I started again, I knew I was in some difficulty because I was shaking. And by the time I got to a small village, a skiing village, I think just 6 miles or so before the end of that first day.
We had to get him into a restaurant that was actually closed, sort of opened the door, got him in, put the lights on, got him a hot drink and a blanket.
I got into hypothermia, and thanks to the lads around me, I got into some shelter and got warm, and apparently insisted that I need a beer, so I went back into moaning Bob mode.
Seeing Ian Wheeler trying to spoon feed Bob hot chocolate while all the while Bob's telling him to F off and get me a beer was a pretty special moment.
But it probably was quite a good check for us because everybody felt stretched on that first day. So we all got back to the hotel and realised what we got ahead of us.
Day two is was the queen stage. Super exciting. You wake up in the morning and you've got the Stelvio.
Lovely hotel in Bormio, coming out, nice weather, and just all of us rolling out all to go up the first side of the Stelvio.
There were, you know, some broken spirits, and you know, all you could do really was just say to the group, look, we're all in this.
We had a later start that day, so it meant that we had a bit of a lie-in. It was going to be very icy first thing, so we didn't have to leave till 10.
Certainly for me personally, I think for most people that was, you know, that was a priority. Of the entire three days.
Everyone who's ridden a bike knows about the Stelvio. I think it's the second highest mountain pass in Europe, and you're just thirsting at the opportunity to get up.
This is the rest day. We've just got to go up a mountain a couple of times.
Yeah, we're feeling good. We just need to, looking at the route profile, working out when we're going to put in the first attack of the day. We're looking out for fun time, Frank. He blindsided us yesterday several times. But as I said to you, Frank, you need to make him stick. That's what needs to happen this time.
Pretty tired.
Have you got a bed?
Very tired. Yeah. Very apprehensive. But it's a lovely morning. And we'll give it a go.
And there to the main road.
Down this way, yeah?
That's it, too late now.
Great that we all started out up the mountain together, and actually for me the first climb that we did, like the back of the Stelvio, was actually more picturesque and beautiful than the iconic side.
I don't think I've ever been to somewhere that is as gorgeous as the Dolomites.
Well, the Stelvio was the sort of the ride, I suppose, because that's what we'd all wanted to do.
When you look at that as a road and look at it as a view, and it's just something, it's picture postcard, it's just, you don't think it's real, really.
It's off out of the town, straight out of the hotel, straight up the Stelvio, started the climb anyway.
Set off wrongly dressed, so my first part of the morning was sort of suffering with overheating.
You can see a long way up the valley, which, you know, can be daunting because you can see how far it is you have really got to go.
The gradient is I think it's about 7%, isn't it? And it's quite consistent. And I just found the Stelvio, it's quite a fluid ride. I mean, I made the mistake of taking the wrong turn in and kind of missing the group, which was a bit of a schoolboy error.
As it turns out, the person leading the race, Daryl, he took the wrong turn, so he was disqualified. So it came down to Gally and I the first time up. And I can't remember, but I think I might have pipped him at the top. Did I pip him at the top? I think I might have pipped him at the top. But anyway, it's not about who comes first.
Yeah, it was nice to get a really good warm-up. I mean, that K and a half to the base of the climb, I think really set us for the day there, didn't it?
Nice to have a chat. We did the crossword.
Yeah, particularly after 100 miles yesterday and hypothermia. So, yeah, good.
I don't know. I think this is my kind of climb. No big ramps, nice road surface. These are the climbs that the triathletes can show themselves on. Sometimes these sketchy, steep ones are... they're not really that decisive, but today this was a decisive climb. That's why we got beds in the top.
I need steeper gradients, mate. Suits my climbing style, especially the weight as well. After the grappa turned into crappa this morning, I felt a bit lighter. Lovely.
Nice work. Well done.
Well done, Stevie.
Laugh.
Laugh. Nice, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Right. Okay, Switzerland's that way, descending, or you can go to the summit, which Martin's done and Ash is doing, to drop down, and then that's the end of their day.
Well, we're going down the other side and then climbing back up.
No.
Here we go, where do you want it? Where are we going?
Anywhere you want.
It's not really. Should we get there, over that one?
Well done.
Yeah?
Yep.
Happy with that?
Well done,
there we go. That was me beating Gaz into four.
Yeah, we got to the decision point where you sort of turn left and descend into Switzerland, and I was feeling a bit tired after day one, admittedly, and a couple of people were talking about just going to the top and having a cutting the day short, which I thought that's probably quite a good idea with day three coming.
And then the decision was whether we went down to Switzerland or just went to the top and then come back down. I chose to go to Switzerland.
So yeah, we decided just to head on up to the top and have a bit of lunch on the top and come back down.
Hey, look, everyone's on holiday. Everyone's there to do whatever they like, but I just can't in my mind think that you would want to go on a cycle trip to the Stelvio and then not cycle up the Stelvio.
To me, you do what you've set out to do unless your leg's hanging off or something like that. But then I wasn't with him at the time when he decided to just turn left instead of right, and if you're with a group of people that are all doing that, then it's easy to stick with them. We can go back again and get Dawny to do the whole route.
If you're not going to complete certain things, definitely day two was not the day to bail out. I'd have to question the fat controller there.
You know, since then I've always regretted not completing that ride because there was people who were suffering more than I was suffering, who did, you know, complete the day. So I think I'll always just live with that regret. I never rode up the other side. But yeah, it was just, I was after just a rest day, really. You know, an easier day. You know, and just in hindsight, I wish I hadn't.
A load of bullshit.
Stelvio is a monster, 48 hairpins, it's a gradient of 8%, 20 something kilometres, relentless from start to finish. There's nowhere to get your breath. The thing that the stats don't underlie is that the effect that the thinning of the air and the lack of oxygen has on your body is massive. So when the fatigue sets in, because you're tired and you've been banging out your effort, it's multiplied then by the fact that your body just can't get enough oxygen in. It's a monster.
Getting there is an ordeal. You know, you're looking at a lot of road ahead of you which has got zero switchbacks in, and you're thinking, are we on the right climb? Yeah. Once you're in that switchback territory and the countdown begins, you know, it starts off at 48 corners and you're thinking, you know, you look ahead and you're just thinking there's more than 48 corners on this one.
As soon as you come out of the trees and take that turn and see the iconic sort of pictures looking down from the top of the Stelvio with the remaining 20 hairpins to go, is quite breathtaking, really.
Oh yeah. You've been climbing for a couple of hours, you're getting quite tired, the air's a bit thin, and then I got the dreaded cooey from Gaz as he started to reel me in.
Good work, boys, thank you.
Alright.
I had about half a kilometre, maybe a kilometre to go, tried to go as fast as I could, and then he came past me about 100 metres later, didn't say a word, bugger.
I actually thought that the signs by the side of the road with numbers on were telling me the degree of bend so that the drivers wouldn't crash. Didn't actually realise they were telling me that there was 48 hairpins to go. You can edit that out.
Looking back down the climb, you know, that sensation of I've done this. Yeah, it's phenomenal, but nobody really tells you about the journey getting there. You know, nobody gives you that insight. And people share the good stuff, but they don't share the hard stuff. And, you know, 80% of that climb is tough going.
How was it, Gaz?
It was tough. There's nothing nice about that climb, I tell you. It was brutal the whole way. Even when you get into the switchbacks, it's just like that. It's ridiculous.
No, but it needs to have a little word with Wheeler, Ian Wheeler. His words were apparently steep in the valley, and then it flattens out.
Go on then.
I don't know which part flattens out, Ian. Come back to me on that one.
Views from the top, you've got the glacier that's spinning down. It was nice warm weather. You have a Coke, you take your picture. Well done, mate. Yeah, and it just feels brilliant.
Fuck me. Dear, look as bad as it felt on camera. That's a lot longer than this morning, wasn't it, that way up? Huh? Over that when my legs are gone.
And you're
really impressed.
Look at this.
Hey.
Cheers, Will.
Yeah.
Thanks, buddy.
Thanks,
looking
guys.
After us.
Yeah. Wow, superstar. It's been beautiful. I don't know. I think the... What was it we did yesterday?
Thanks. Gavia.
Gavia.
Cheers, Frank. See you, mate. Frank.
Gavia?
Yeah.
I think the Gavia was easier than that. Oh, I do.
Do you?
Yes.
No, I think the Gavia was harder.
No, that was horrible, that was.
But it was horrible either way.
Yeah, that was not a nice ride up.
Well done, boys.
Yeah.
Can't talk.
I need to drink. I need some beer. And maybe some grappa. And maybe some Bordolino. And maybe Brunello di Montalcino. Cheers. 3 hours of shut up legs. At a 50-year-old old git up those bends down there. So if you can just turn round, my good man, and get the pictures of the bends. And up here is Mickey D. Happy 50th, Mickey D, and happy 50th as when you get in.
Is it going to be the toughest 4Ks you've ever done, you think? Or
probably, yeah.
Probably, yeah.
All we've got to do is get to that fucking hotel. That's it, that hotel there, roughly, isn't it?
I was really fortunate on this trip. I was mostly riding with Dono and Northy. I knew it got tough when Dono stopped talking. For me, it was actually seeing Northy get to the top.
I was going to quit. The people you're with convince you that you can do it, you carry on.
And he was just so happy to be there. He was grinning from ear to ear, you know, bearing in mind 5 years ago he had his heart attack. He never thought he'd be able to do anything like that. So for me, getting him to the top and seeing him happy was everything.
The descent off the Stelvio, you know, 30 mile an hour, there's nobody around, just absolutely awesome.
There's very few times that you ever turn you on a bike, but that descent
was stunning. I really enjoyed that. It was in the sun.
And then you get to the switchback side, you know, taking over Ferraris and Porsches. And
you could really pick the nice bends, and it was just breathtaking.
So Pricey flew past at a rate of knots. I'm never going to keep up with you on the descent, Pops.
It was a great achievement for everyone to achieve that. Climbing it twice in one day is not for the faint of heart.
That was a great day. Short day in comparison, but tough, but very exciting.
It's safe to say that waking up on day three was not an easy process.
Knowing it was going to be a long day, and I think there was a little bit of nervous silence as well. The spirits were quite high.
The final day was you're getting a bit uncomfortable. You know what's in front of us. I didn't know what was in front of us. I guessed what was in front of us. I didn't realise it was going to be as tough as it was.
And probably steering the bike down the road was probably the trickiest cycling of the trip.
The slower group went out first, so we're actually on the climb when the fast boys caught us, so that's nice having a quick word as they come past, if they could breathe.
They know the words.
No, rien de rien. No, je ne regrette rien.
Any regret?
Ça suffit.
I found it very pretty. Through the wooded bits at the bottom, I think it only averaged sort of 6-7% towards the bottom, so there was long, long flat sections of a couple of percent.
Je ne regrette rien.
You have no regrets?
Always best off regretting the things you've done, not the things you haven't.
Felt like a side path, didn't feel like a proper structured road. You know, it's only for the back half of it going towards sort of top end. And yeah, I think in my mind, because you'd looked at the stats on paper and you think this is going to be properly brutal, there were bits of it. I think it was about a 15% section where when I looked down, I realised I got a couple of gears to play with, and I didn't realise that. So that was a nice feeling. Still doing this, you know, right? Oh, sure.
I suppose there's two things that caught up with me on the day, probably most of the other cyclists, but more importantly, the grappa. I think that was probably part self-inflicted, part due to fines, due to, lots of indiscretions along the trip. So the last day was probably one of the worst days ever on a bike.
You could hear the sheep in the fields, and you could hear the heavy breathing of Galley half a mile behind you trying to catch you up.
So that gave me a nice little target to aim for. So it's nice to run him down. And then as I was getting towards the top, I just heard this tick, 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 tick behind. And obviously Price is coming through like a rate of knots.
Is that fun, mate? This is what the Mortirolo does to you.
There are some parts where it's 16%. I've got a slight issue with hills where they give you the signpost of the average gradient coming up, because it just deflates. It just deflates me when it goes over 7 or 8%. But there was 1 kilometre where the steepest ramp was 16%, and You know, all I could smell was the grappa coming out of my body, and it was horrific.
Yes. You know, and that for me meant the last probably 4K. It made it meaningful again. So I'm not just tapping it out. I've just got something to try and work towards. And that's what it is. It's people pushing you, whether it's directly or indirectly. You're pushing. Yeah, enjoyable within music. Let out, open eyes, don't you hear me cry?
Come? Va bene, Mortirolo.
Broke the man right here. Ask him how he's feeling. How you feeling?
Pretty broke.
Go on, Greg.
Nothing need to get in there.
Give us a bite then. Mate, if you want to get in the van, just get in the van. It's there, look. Just get in.
At no get in, point will his beds allowed in the van.
Of course he's not allowed in the van.
Is he allowed in the van?
Come back for the bike. Mate, just leave the bike. You're never going to use it ever again. So you don't get a roof rack.
The cheap con Argo for sale if anyone's interested. Very little use.
I'm done for. I'm back to punching him. Definitely. In fact, this time I think I'm going to nut him as well. We'll put a big sharp object up his arse. Yeah, sideways.
How are we feeling then, boys?
Feeling all right, thanks.
Yeah.
Just tapping it out.
Catching up on the gossip.
Looking forward to lunch.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Enjoying my lunch.
That's it. Yeah.
I'll film me getting down in case something really bad happens.
Oh, you break their big, their pride of.
It is a bit humiliating to see a man of steel get into the bus.
You know, he's got his reasons for having to get in the van.
That's not to say that his bike missed out. You know, and his bike, I think, absolutely loved the rest of the day. It got ridden properly, it took the bends properly, it did lots of bunny hops, wheelies. It was good to see Beds' bike having a good day out, despite Beds actually sitting it out in the van.
Sorry about your bike, mate.
Bit of lack of mental strength, I think. But yeah, had a pretty bad day, bonked, and obviously won't ever live that one down.
Are you suiting back up?
No, I need to keep warm in the van.
Is that what it is?
Yeah. I'd love to, but Will's nicked me bike.
And what have the boys had to say about
Where's
that?
My leggings on?
I think I'll have plenty to say later on.
What I want to know is, based on today, does this make Will a professional cyclist? No, but I mean, he's the only one paid to ride today, so surely he is the only professional here.
Beds, you just need to train harder, Pop. It's all right doing the gym, it's all right doing your little 30-second sprint efforts with Cripsy, but, you know, you just got to start manning up again. This is an endurance-based sport. You've got to be in there, it's got to be strong, it's got to be in there as well. Do I feel let down? Yeah. I feel let down.
We all sort of set out together but broke up during it, and I had a little bit of a ride on that with Will, who was borrowing Betsy's bike because he was having a little lie down in the van, I think, at that point. Rode with Frank for a little bit, rode with Boydie and Gaz, and then Paul Wheeler, pedalling squares. Who knew Paul Wheeler would ever pedal squares? Couldn't quite believe it.
You know you've got to get through the day. You know you've there's Beds is in the van, so there's no space. You've got to do it, haven't you?
the group sort of stopped at the bottom, I can remember, and I'd already ridden part way up the very first road out of the village, and I sat on a bench, and at that point I was thinking that van looks pretty attractive.
And then also you'd see Bob and in what bad shape he was in, and you go, well, he's made it over the Stelvio twice when he looked like he could only do half of it, so that makes you kind of dig in a bit more as well.
It gave me another shot in the arm to think, I'm not doing that. Just not getting out of bloody van, whatever. And, you know, so we just tapped it out and got the top of the hill.
Let's live a bit. Let's live a bit, all that salt. Hey, buddy. Gary, I love you. I think you're marvellous.
1,674 metres, and I've climbed 3,090 metres today so far. ETA is 7:05, according to that, if we keep on the pace that we've been going today so far. So,
how long in the saddle would that be?
Today, oh gosh, 6 hours, what's the time now, another 3. Be about 9-10 hours, that's all. More than that.
Where are we going actually? I think we're going downhill now for...
We're going home.
16k, and then there's a picture of a pint of beer in 16k. I'm not sure. I think we've only got one little 4k climb to go.
Folder there.
That's nice, but I think we're pretty much downhill for the next 50 miles. Which would be nice.
I think it's about a 4k climb.
A 4k climb in its own way. Yeah.
How was that?
Tough first half.
Yeah.
And it eased out a bit. God. But the signs kept saying 5k. 5k. Oh, then another 5k. Okay. Cheers.
Now, and you've got a long way back still. It's going to be dark, it's going to be cold, but it's all downhill, and the exhilaration of finishing sort of carries you through. So once I've gone over the top of the final ascent, I got that long descent, I knew I could do it.
I was following Funtime Frankie and Will. I don't think they had lights, couldn't see a lot.
Because we only had one front light between the group of five of us, so that wasn't quite ideal.
The lights by the lake were miles down, and it just seemed to take forever to get there, but you knew the end was in sight, so...
I didn't doubt I could finish, not after that final ascent. So for me, to do it at my age, alongside younger people, that's just fantastic.
What I love about cycling, and the trip was just amazing, and the evenings were pretty special.
And everybody looked forward to it. You know, it was a means of just enjoying the day together, knowing what everybody else got up to during that day.
I think it was over 200 odd kilometres, but it's just another one of those days that I can look back and say, yeah, I did that, and I did it well. So, yeah, I'm really pleased.
For a bunch of average cyclists to achieve what we did, I think it's exceptional.
If I could describe the trip in 3 words, it would be hard, hilarious, and hungover.
Cold, long, but enjoyable.
Iconic, emotional, enduring.
Challenging, enjoyable, and memorable.
Hilly, cold, and inspirational.
Amazing cycling adventure.
Grappa, Gavia, and Galley.
Exhilarating, challenging, and rewarding.
Awesome, challenging, friendship.
Everyone's backside is probably looking like the map out of Bonanza on the opening credits by now. But it was a lovely day. I quite like day three because everyone's got the testosterone out the system. Well, almost. And you kind of mix a bit. And it seemed to be like a goober celebration day today, didn't it? It's kind of like, you know, people were talking to goobers and people were turning into goobers, weren't they, Beds? And, you know, it was almost like a national hugger goober day. For fuck's sake, I even put lights on my bike at 4 o'clock, so it must be contagious. But it was a lovely atmosphere cycling with the goobers, which brings us on to the first award of the evening. Now, my phone was ringing red hot today. I had two big bike manufacturers ringing me, and they wanted to fight over the title for My Bike Needs a Better Rider. I had Pinarello and I had Colnago on the line, both paying big bucks for this. Anyway, Ara, I find it quite difficult to understand how you can cycle so slowly. I know I fined you for it yesterday, and that was the Cirque du Soleil award. But my first fine is to you and your Pinarello. Well done. Now, I did promise I'd go easy on Beds. But actually, after seeing what Will can actually do on your bike, if your bike was a missus, she'd have left you ages ago. Well, unbelievable.